house shows are usually pretty horrible, you know, and so you charge tons of money for them, you know, because they're so miserable. And a lot of times it's like somebody's brother-in-law who, you know, wants you to play, and they'll hire you to come and you sit and play at the piano that's totally out of tune, and everybody's really drunk and nobody pays any attention to you, and they give you a check and tell you to leave. That's my house party experience, but this is quite a bit different, I think. Hopefully. Was born in 1886, so he was like 60 years old when I was born. My mother was a barrel house piano player who was the first woman thrown out of SMU. My dad became he bought an old defunct church in Lubbock and started throwing dances on the weekends, and then that kind of parlayed that into doing wrestling matches and boxing matches and what, and became kind of the local entrepreneur and promoter in Lubbock. On Friday nights, he would throw all black dances, very segregated during that. This was like late 40s, early 50s, but on Friday night, there were all black dances and had great players, people like T-Bone Walker and Jimmy Reed, Blues Boy King, B.B. King. But they would come through, and everybody was like a touring band at that time, so they would come through and play Lubbock, go to Amarillo, go to Denver, whatever, wherever they were going. Then on Saturday night was the same, but it was kind of all white country Hank Williams and Ernest Tubb and Little Jimmy Dickens, all those people that were, you know, on the road touring bands. But I grew up hearing these amazing stories that they told about baseball and about music and just their transient lives. Rock and roll had a huge, it's a cliche, but it had a huge impact in the mid-50s in a lot of rural, especially, had all over, but especially in these little rural towns when that stuff started coming in on the radio. It was the first time that it wasn't God, family, country, school. It was about you. Blue suede shoes, you know, don't step on my blue suede shoes. You know, it had nothing to do with that other stuff. Also, the automobile, and there's no memory before you get your first car because there was no reason to have a memory. But when you got the first car, you took that thing and you drove it on these flat, dead farm roads as fast as you could drive it with the headlights going, the radio was lousy, and that was a huge release.
Yeah, this is a road that runs between Lubbock and Amarillo, Texas. And if you're from Amarillo, it's called the Lubbock Highway. If you're from Lubbock, it's called Amarillo Highway.
I don't really know how songs come about, actually, because I believe it's a total mystery how that happens and where they come from. most art I feel that way about. I never thought that there was an issue about doing a song, doing a picture, doing an object, doing a theater, a performance or whatever. It all seemed like one thing to me from the very beginning. And you put a label on things and call something so you don't have to think about it. I was just never interested in that. Bucca was playing this kind of beautiful melody on the accordion. And I just said that for some reason that makes me think of the death of the last stripper. And Dave Allen said, write that down. And next thing we know, we started working on that lyric. And then Joe Harvey threw some lines in. So went back in December when I knew I was going to do the Paramount show. And I wanted to do all new songs. I think it was because, like I told you, I'd been crawling down memory lane for so long with the archives. It's like everything was about the past, kind of, and I'm just itching to get in my studio and make some new things and write some new songs. That was kind of really the impetus of the record. The truth kind of is plural, you know, and there's all aspects of the truth of one thing. One thing's funny, another thing's horrible, one thing's soft, another thing's hard. Mean, kind, and it's all the truth. And I think when you're working with whatever subject, a song or whatever, you're trying to find the right aspect of that to tell the truth with whatever you're doing. And sometimes it's outrageous, sometimes it's cold-blooded serious. I think you don't know until you really stick your head in it and start playing and start working. You don't really know what truth you're going to find in there. Anytime you do something new, it's very hard to get your bullshit in order talking about it because you're still trying to figure out what to say about it. But ultimately, anything you say about it doesn't mean anything when you put it next to the thing that you're doing because that's what it is.
It's called Death of the Last Stripper. It's a very sad song. She had a boy. Some guy from Fresno. Where he is now, none of us know. She had a number on some paper in her purse. That was a number we tried first. Thank you. they shut down the mill, and now there's no one around. She was the last stripper, the last club in town. Can't say that I knew her, and can't say we were friends, but I still try that.
Kansas, and spent the first 2 years of my life in Amarillo. And my folks, we lived in a house they really loved. And so when we moved to Lubbock, they took the floor plans of this house in Amarillo to Lubbock. And when they got enough money, they built the an exact replica of the Amarillo house in Lubbock. And that was the house I grew up in. Then when my father died and my mother and I went to California, and my mother sold the house and kind of bounded around for a while. And then she moved back to Amarillo to live in that original house and actually tried to buy it from the woman living in it who wouldn't sell it. So she bought another house kind of down the street from it and waited for this woman to die, you know, so that she could buy this original house. And that's what she did. The woman died. She got this house. So it was so bizarre when we'd go back for Christmas or any kind of holiday, anytime we visited my mother, we were going to the exact same house I grew up in Lubbock, but it was in Amarillo, and it was furnished exactly the same, you know. You don't think I'm going to sit down and make something funny. It's not the way it works. It's something that's built into the reality of whatever you're dealing with. I think especially in some very heavy or dark subjects, you know, that happens. Anytime you start talking about death, you have to laugh because it's so bizarre that, you know, that it's something that we're all sitting here to, you know, with our lives and whatever. And 100 years from now, it's just, so what, you know, or maybe not so what. I don't know what.
I'll do one more here. Singing on the radio. forgiveness to hold it on.